Thanks for the invitation. Thanks also for the museum for hosting the whole thing. And thanks also, Jan, for approaching me initially to kind of start all the this day and also the trip that we are going to have in the next day. So I'm looking forward to that. I changed my title in the very last moment. It's the same title, in fact, Universal Solutions, but it changed it from Vienna's housing during the Cold War into boredom and housing in Vienna and elsewhere during the early days of the Cold War, trying to introduce boredom because I think it's so important in housing. So basically what my contribution tries to do is to revisit some of the aspects of the architecture in the model of social housing as it established in Vienna and in Europe during the period between the, let's say, 40s up until the late 60s. And it might be quite important to mention that this specifically focuses in for the Austrian case to the city of Vienna and not so much on the countryside, which is a very, very different story, I would say. Then I have to apologize because I'm in the middle of doing my research. The whole thing will be rather fragmentic and I will not be able to come up with a very clear and sound argument, I would say. But it's rather thinking out loudly on the basis of that material. So this longer perspective that I'm trying to develop is to shed light on architecture with the background of production, consumption, distribution of housing, and its effects on architecture. And this somehow lies with the conception of housing as some, let's say, governmental device, as we already had it, I think, in the morning, especially, with the idea of architecture as a technology of building a new society. But I think this will just unfold within the presentation. So with the Second World War just a few days over, a new war dominated the second half of the world's 20th century and separated the so-called West from what this West called the Eastern Bloc, that is the Soviet states and its allies, or the satellite states. It was termed cold, as this has been argued, as this was a war that was not waged in open conflict or in large-scale combat, but whatever that means. But that was a war that was led through a series of regional wars, heavily backed up by the superpowers, on proxy wars, on an armed race for a nuclear world war. But it was also a war that was waged on very different other levels, like the space race, for example, the influence in the decolonizing world, the economic strife for proving one system ahead of the other with the planned economies on the one side and liberal capitalism on the other. And this war did not leave out technology, culture, or design, nor did it leave out infrastructure such as housing. So this Cold War became a war that was actually led on every level. On July 24th of 1959, the Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev encountered the then Vice President of the United States, Richard Nixon, and the two met here at Saloniki Park in Moscow at the opening of the American National Exhibition. This was a fair that was basically an answer to another exhibition held at the same year in organized by the Soviet Union in New York. And these shows, which were actually announced as some sort of a cultural exchange program in order to ease the tensions by showing how each one lived, actually they became something like a show of what the respective system had to offer. So they became one of these examples of the of that war waged on all spheres of everyday life. And the part of the technical or scientific or cultural achievements, particularly in Moscow, this show featured the newest achievement of consumer cultures, like cars, home entertainment, televisions, leisure goods, domestic appliances, or here a robotic Hoover. So in order to demonstrate the advantages of capitalism to sell the American dream, and part of this show was also a so-called typical American home built and exhibited here. And Khrushchev and Nixon, they met at the heart of this house. So the stage of this contest between the two powers became the kitchen, a battle that became known as the kitchen debate. And this kitchen was equipped with all sorts of fancy facilities like a microwave oven, dishwasher, and things like that. So it basically showed the massive leap of the United States in that they have had undergone with the promotion of capitalism. But what was at stake here as well was nothing less but the straightforward winner of the future. And as Nixon stated, any worker could afford such a kitchen and buy such a house on a contract by like 25 years. Such a home was also very well within reach for the socialist worker Khrushchev then encountered. But while the Americans built only for 20 years because they want to sell new houses, the Soviets built for eternity, for their children and for their grandchildren. And moreover, the American chance of buying a new house was based on money, while the Soviets built or offered housing to all. So while Khrushchev here argued almost on the basis of a right to housing, Nixon promoted something like a right to choose and a system that basically always takes advantage of the ever new consumer good. While on the Soviet side, the satisfaction of the basic need was the prior concern that Russian people have a home. Although the show in New York mainly featured the Sputnik and the industrial achievements, also the Soviet exhibition here gave an idea of the lifestyle featured by the Soviet Republic and its concept of housing, and mainly this was built on prefabricated concrete walls. The reason to go for prefabrication was quite clear. We heard about that already. So to simplify and speed up production, to raise the number of units that were so needed so desperately. And they were introduced in the post-Stalinist era and kept up until the 1980s. And this project was, or the program was, linked so much to Khrushchev that even the type was then became known as the Khrushchevka. So what we basically have with these two shows is some sort of two opposing systems with a corresponding system in housing, with the single-family home on the one side, along with liberal capitalism and the idea of the prefab home on the side of the planned economy of the USSR. At the very same year, the two exhibitions took place in Moscow and New York. Representatives of Vienna actually went to the Soviet Union in order to visit housing schemes and prefab plants and planning in offices. So Vienna basically had decided to give prefabrication a try, as other European cities already had done before. And this team consisted out of architects and engineers from the municipality, and their research mainly concerned the construction system and the implementation of that model. And similar trips also led them to France or the Netherlands, for example. Michi was speaking about that before, so I can shorten that part. So it's even the same picture, I think, the same image. Should be better, yeah. So what is important, I think, just to underline and to repeat with Michi's remark was that the provision of social housing in Vienna was very much linked to rent control. That it, at that time, even in the 1960s then, speaking from that perspective, that housing still was substantially built and provided by the local state, and that this rent control, when it was introduced, that it kind of got a strong backing of that it was not so much a socialist measure, but it was a wider policy in order to keep wages down. One introduced these the rent caps in order by law, by signing them to law, in order to reduce the rents, in order to have kind of the very good starting point for an export-oriented economy, particularly for paying back the reparations after the First World War. But these rent caps, in fact, so they were rather supporting the industry than the working class. In fact, they were kept until the 1960s, but they underwent a very significant change, I would say. And as Michi already mentioned as well, they introduced new taxes, and yeah, you already explained the housing program. So after the Second World War, the reconstruction of Vienna literally started out of the ruins. So something like 187,000 dwellings were affected by the war, half of them inhabitable, and the city also ran short on food and coal. And as early as in June 45, an inquiry into the reconstruction of Vienna took place. And here, basically, experts discussed whether to reconstruct Vienna in its existing patterns or to build it anew. And actually, one concluded with the comment that reconstruction means making it better. So, Planning Council argued for decongestion, for something like the credo of modern city planning, for scientific planning, and basically, it does not only reflect the scientific turn of planning of the wider European discourses, but also the strong influence of nationalist socialist planning onto the Viennese debates. The whole thing of reconstruction in Austria grew very soon into something like a national narrative, which very often, and more than often, fed a false myth of Austria as the first victim of the Nazis. So the reconstruction can also be considered as a collective endeavor of forgetting the past. The first major housing project, we already talked about that even before, was was the Per-Albin Hansen Siedlung, started in 47, designed by Franz Schuster, Egon Wörle, and Michael Engelhardt, and all of them had been involved in housing before, and they also had been involved in planning during the Nazi period, and actually all of them could continue without hindrance. So, but not only the architects, also the planning schemes here tell from that continuity of the Nazis, because the whole settlement had been developed as a part of an urban expansion program during the Nazi period. The settlement here shows some rather modern, minimalist, functionalist floor plans, along and combined with the style of the Heimatschutz, let's say. So we have, at the same time, a modern logic and a reactionary language. And the houses were built, this was already mentioned before, from bricks, which were so-called Vipro bricks, you can see them on the left, made by a machine provided by the state of Sweden as a first aid measure for reconstruction, that allowed to make bricks from pressed rubble. So basically, it's a new housing scheme built on old plans from the Nazis, from the rubble of the ruins. And this ambiguity of the whole thing of the stands for a whole program. This ambiguity between fascist planning ideology and, on the other hand, the name that Per Albin Hansen here gave as kind of the founder of the Swedish welfare state, the settlement was named after, and who, like no other, embodied prosperity, democracy, and social advancement, as Bruno Kreisky, the later chancellor, also mentioned at the opening of this settlement. So in the dilemma how residential space could be provided in the best way, we just remember the single family home and state provision, actually Vienna just came back to its very own model of housing provision. And given this wartime destruction, the shortages, the lack of money, and the kind of the dependence on international aid, which then was centrally distributed, it was quite clear that Vienna was ultimately forced to some sort of a planned economy, which should, in a way, persist or last in municipal housing over decades then after. But it was quite clear that the Social Democrats here could not go back to the pathetic architecture of Red Vienna, but rather one referred to housing concept, the new housing concept, as mentioned, of Sweden, for example, or also from the UK. One quite important thing is that post-fascist Austria is characterized by a very strong desire for political consensus. And it always strives for compromise between the conservatives and the socialist sides. So it's almost an ideal of universal harmony, which is rooted based in the experience of the Civil War, then of the war, but also in the idea of fascism, of an almost unambiguous society. And this strongly fed into the cooperative structure of Austria, and it had a lasting effect also on housing. So, and moreover, housing was accredited, and also architecture was accredited, a very strong role in the idea of building up a new society, like coming back in slogans like, first it's the house, first the people build the houses, then it's the houses that build the people. And we can see that slogan in various forms coming back. But in order to retrace that role of housing, I think it's necessary to shed light on Vienna's environment at the time and how it became immersed in the Cold War. So after Vienna was liberated in 1945 by the Soviet troops, it was subdivided into four sectors and occupied by the Allies. And Vienna's surrounding was held by the Soviets. This was the region that was actually affected most heavily by the war, with a major part of the old pre-war industry laying in ruins, and also a considerable part of the housing stock destroyed. And following the Potsdam agreements, the former German property, like industrial property, was rightfully claimed as reparations by the Allies. And the Red Army, for example, confiscated the property by literally dismantling it in Austria, shipping it to Russia and reassembling there. And later on, they somehow moved over to gathering production in the so-called Usia, something like, we could say, a Soviet state corporation on Austrian ground in order to maximize profit. But I think it's also important that we should not forget that the Soviet Union was, in terms of losses, it faced the biggest losses from the Second World War, actually. And from this, from the perspective of liberal Western capitalism, Europe's stability was highly contested. So with the major cities in rubble, with the left growing stronger in Italy, in France, for example, as well, with the role of Germany quite unclear, so the US considered Europe under a communist threat. And against this background, the United States launched the European Recovery Program, also called the Marshall Plan. And this plan contained massive financial material aids given on several preconditions. First of all, national cooperation, fostering the free trade and liberal democracy, the reintegration of Germany so as to consolidate Europe on the basis of that economy, and also what came later, basically, the strategic embargo against the communist demon. The ERP basically meant waging war on, or meant waging the Cold War on the level of support. Moscow, and that's quite known, was obviously against the program, named it imperialist, and didn't allow its satellite states to take part, except from Austria, which became the sole state or nation under Soviet occupancy to receive the Marshall Plan funds. And so the ERP followed a very deliberate funding system. So the nations were given grants in order to invest them on approved investments. And these credits were to be repaid on a national level into the so-called counterpart fund, money that was then used for reinvestment. So it rather supported businesses than public services for consumption like housing. So the amount of credits given to housing were rather low, like 5% of the total sum. And it was rather invested in the areas, in the western areas of Austria, and not so much in the in the area around Vienna. Vienna and its surrounding, which was the area affected most severely by the war and where scarcity was the rule, was partly economically blocked by the Soviets, and it also remained out of a major international investment. So the enormous investment into housing, I would suppose, or I would suggest, need to be regarded against the background of this disproportional development of Vienna, that the lack of private investment and the social Soviet influence. So I would suggest to reading the post-war housing programs, not only as a strategy against the shortage or scarcity in housing, but as some sort of a compensation strategy in Austria, so in order to stimulate the local economy. And the Austrian strategy, taking again the dispossession by the Allies, particularly by the Soviets, was basically the communalization of heavy industry. And since even the United States agreed as a liberal state, Russia turned in, and basically it ensured the supply with cheap pre-products in order to stimulate economy. And as I mentioned before, all that was done under very strong national consensus in order to all the steering of national industry, all the investments, and even wage restraints, so found that consensus in order to foster economy. I would just go over and show a very short film. Where is it? So we could read the development of housing in Vienna along these lines of that program. The investment into housing, into movable goods, countered first of all the scarcity of accommodation. At the same time, however, they boosted the building industries and its suppliers. They created jobs, secured buyers in building material industry, like the brick industry. Because it was public housing, distributed at very low rents, it allowed also to keep the wages down, which is the best starting position for exports and prosperous business activity. Furthermore, the production of residential space created something like a vacuum, a blank space that could be filled then with the desires of a forthcoming consumer society. So this vision of prosperity, of growth and social upgrade is already inscribed into the post-war housing program. How to achieve all that was it was possible, first of all, by massive investment into the production of residential space. So it was taking two-thirds of the whole building budget, 20% of the total municipal budget in the year 54, for example. Then it was achieved by by the standardization of floor plans of the building process in order to minimize the production cost. It was also achieved by concentrating on inner city areas first. Poor resolution here. Concentrating on the inner city first, where land was developed along sewage systems and streets, and only going outside in the 60s, when the technology of heavy cranes and large-scale construction required more space. And it was also possible by specifically planning for the core family, which came to be the cell of this post-war society, and rendering a new lifestyle with new consumer products of living, for living possible. So this was the introduction of a series of affordable interior furniture, so in order to recruit totally new user groups. And in this encompassing role, I would suggest to conceptualize Vienna's housing scheme as something like a medium of European Fordism. So in the idea of regulation theory, for example, this, that concept considers capitalist society as something like as historically changing forms of regimes of accumulation, which organize production, distribution, and consumption. And in Fordism, this is also characterized by standardization, consumption, and also by high profit margins linked to increasing social wealth. Correspondingly, in regulation theory, there is a mode of regulation, what I tried to somehow describe before, a heterogeneous set of norms, institution, agreements, like the one linked to the welfare state or to state corporations, that basically reproduce society. And housing here takes a twofold role. First of all, the cell, the unit, becomes a more and more standardized thing in or object or product in production and consumption, while at the same time it's a tool, a device for reproducing the social patterns of the core family. So even if reconstruction was actually completed in the 1950s, late 50s, and the shortages were adjusted, the demand remained at a quite high level, and so social housing remained at the core of the capitalist welfare state. But up until then, the production of social housing in Vienna more or less was done or applied the same techniques as it did 100 years before. So it was basically built by bricks. It was built with labor-intense, skilled workforce. And in the immediate post-war period, that was quite clear since the labor costs were quite low. But they increased over the years of prosperity. And by the end of the 1950s, they were at a level that actually they became the main driving force for moving towards industrialized prefabrication. So after that, research team went to Russia, and they had visited their panel systems and all over the world. One decided for the Camus system that was patented in, I think, 48 or 49 as the earliest system and probably the one tested the most often. So in Vienna, where the economic plans were set up, and in 61, the Montagebau GmbH was founded as a company. An architectural competition was launched and announced and made Oskar and Peter Payer the designers of roughly 10,000 dwelling units. But these architects did not only account for the layout of the floor plans, as we can see it here, they were also quite well-known authors of interior guidebooks, as you see here, and they were designers, and they also had launched their own interior and furnishing store called Bayer Decor, which offered the fitting interiors and contributed actually considerably to the dissemination of that modern consumer culture in interiors in Vienna. But the construction of these blocks followed the urban planning concept for Vienna by Roland Reiner. In fact, they were drawn up according to purely economic criteria, so we could say here form follows fabrication. That optimization of that floor plan was bought with a limitation of freedom, I would say. So it was particularly focusing on the functionalization of that plan, which here seemed to apply particularly on the reproduction of idealized values along the core family. So we have here functional plans oriented to the light, short ways, and the rationalization of the so-called back workshop of the household, the kitchen. And these neat family homes were also clearly gendered. So finally, just to quote the architects, according, the housewife has an overview of the entire apartment from her commando station as she works. The children are always in the mother's field of view. So the home primary considered is here considered as a site of reproduction, of labor reproduction, of consumption, and of the family. And quite soon, these uniform schemes met harsh criticism, the complaint of monotony and the homogenization of lifestyles. So this showed neustädtische Wohnformen, new urban forms of living, showed designs for the city as a collective overall building, and the two projects could be considered as part of that, a result to somehow out of that critique on the standardization of needs and of the floor plans. At the same time, we shouldn't forget that actually something like a right to housing had never been closer to being met than during these prosperous years of mass production. The Montagebau panel system was abandoned in the late 60s, and all I think something like 34,000 units were built. The panel system that the Montagebau used was essentially the same as the one applied in the USSR. It is the standard panel, also called the KPD, an abbreviation of large panel system. That was itself an adaptation of the Camus system with an improved production process. So it was introduced during while turning off Stalinism in the Khrushchev period for a new model that built on the technological solution of the housing question. So speed, cost, and year-round production, as well as the lack of skilled labor force, made industrialization the only way that Khrushchev underlined in his seminal speech in 56, 57, that should change the future of Soviet construction. And this call for expediency and rationality was literally the break-off with the architecture of the past. Just to quote him, what people effectively need is houses to live instead of decoration of buildings. And between 57 and 18, the late 80s, around 50 million apartments were erected in the planning units of the micro-rayons. The KPD was also one of the technologies in the USSR spread over the world from the 8 to Cuba in the 8 to Cuba in 63 after a hurricane. Here in Chile, there is a wonderful book about the implementation of the KPD in Chile, to places such as in Kabul after the Soviet invasion in Afghanistan. So in the KPD, industrial housing became what has been called a civilizing device, a technological system that under the excuse of an exchange of expertise distributed ideology in an almost neocolonial manner. Using industrialization or industrialized housing as a tool for reorganizing production. We just might ask why, considering that Soviet colonization, as it very often is, when in fact the two worlds at least in Europe, shared a fundamental structural system. So what can, on the level of production architecture and the level of aesthetics, be drawn from all that, from all these parallels during the Cold War? So I would suggest to consider rationalization, standardization, and industrialization as almost necessary in the post-war period of housing. The rigidity of the panel marks somehow a culmination point, but it has been laid out before. So given in the case, so if given in the case of Vienna, only a part of the housing of the total stock was panel housing, only a part of the total housing stock is made by panel housing, I would, the logics of it, standardization, the repetition of style, the same types, the rational facade, for example, that what we could call the architectural boredom was part of housing long before. And because the industrial panel brought the ultimate turn, I will focus here, and given or facing the fact that I'm running out of time, which will concentrate on the panel here, and most of it counts for standardized housing in itself. So the suggestion of a Cold War dualism between communism and capitalism in residential space, between the single-family house and concrete panel housing, obviously falls short of reality, because Europe, as we know, new prefab housing on both sides of the so-called concrete curtain. So even if spatially the so-called East was coined much more because of higher production rates, the technology and its social impacts cannot be reduced to one side. The panel is what could be called a common piece of history inscribed in the regimes in both socio-economical regimes on different levels. The Camus system and its adaptation became the 20th century probably most influential architectural gesture. While the floor plans or the detailing may vary from one location to another, the architectural logic remains. So the panel does not know whether it is a thing of the East or the West. And stripped down to its naked core, the system and its principle of joining is essentially the same. Massive panels of reinforced concrete equipped with iron bars and hooks composed by cranes like a house of cards, and each joint of between filled with liquid concrete. It's basically systems that produce structurally solid buildings and nothing more. So the immediate conclusion that we could draw from that would be that standardized housing or housing in itself or architecture in itself is not political. Rather, it is a technology that can be instrumentalized in any sense, no matter what the background is, be it capitalist or communist. On both sides of the these sorts of housing were considered as some sort of a service, or almost a public infrastructure. But what persisted in both systems is the idea that it's a device for building society. But it's strange enough that it is the technology for building the prospective communist society on the one side, and the infrastructure offered so as to back up the new consumer society to come on the other side. So architecture, we could say, is not political, but like anything, it can be politicized. Paradoxically, also the reverse conclusion could be drawn, that architecture is political. But I'm not speaking of party politics here, but of a deeper political level inscribed into architecture. So the panel is political in the sense that it refers to a specific constellation between population and state. And that constellation materializes in the panel, its form of production in the way how it is produced here, but also in the way how it reproduces society. What constitutes the panel across the political landscape? It's precast panels, it builds essentially on the economies of scale. So amortization rates can only be reached in highest numbers. Based on endless repetition, the panel needs to be made, carried and assembled by heavy machines. Its production is industrial. So no longer building is a craft executed locally by individuals, but it's labor done in factories. So you cannot build a panel house on your own. The panel entails a fundamental restructuring of the production and also of everyday life. So the decision is given over or handed over to a central administrative force. Its planning is taken care of by a high-ranking power that knows or rather defines the needs and the desires of the people. So when housing as a governmental device developed by the motivations of countering scarcity, raising hygiene and living quality, so in order to achieve reproduced labor power and to ward off revolts, it did not do so by addressing the individual. It rather directs towards the population as a totality. It tries to optimize the population, make it more efficient, while actually it constitutes the population as a new reality, which makes it as some sort of a key example of what has been called biopolitics. And in standardized housing, this understanding of housing was at its height, I would say. And particularly from that perspective, it opened to the accusation of strong paternalism, that it would not reflect actual needs, that is soulless and so on. Nothing but a disciplinary device. But shifting the attention from the disciplinary mechanism onto the body towards matter or to the things in housing provides a different perspective. I just want to highlight that. One aspect of governing population through space always concerned providing egalitarian living conditions, so in order to achieve an egalitarian society, and this found translated into standardization. On the level of architecture, this standardization did away with the discipline as we know it. So in the face of the panel, the idea of the architectural play, the artistic representation of the static forces in the facade, for example, they become meaningless. So the panel replaced architectural representation. Also, its spatial planning schemes replaced architectural decision-making. And like it or not, but this sort of an ahistoric and scientific approach is just one result of the avant-garde of the 1920s. It's really an architecture of degree zero, dispossessed of any meaning that's outside itself. It's just the architecture for housing the masses. So we know all about the problems that arose with the modernist planning and also about the postmodern turn that followed, but I considered worth retracing just one quality of that standardized architecture of degree zero. Apart from providing inhabitable space at low cost, standardized housing also imports a quality that derives from monotony. So the building, which at first sight seem alienating or inhuman, they actually become familiar because they look the same. So sameness, repetition, and boredom establish some sort of an equality that both the state socialist as well as the social democratic welfare state took advantage of. And this equality that is hard to see from a contemporary mainstream perspective, I would say, in cultural aesthetics, which actually shares a preference for the new, for difference, for the heterogeneous, and actually dislikes repetitive uniformity. But we shouldn't forget that this perspective in cultural aesthetics is also formed by the aesthetics of market capitalism, in which difference is above all the difference among commodity. So the repetitive uniformity, and that's the quality here, of this boring housing did not only do it with the architectural object, but even more, it took the commodity status from housing on the level of aesthetics. So if every unit looks the same, it also pays the same. Sounds the non-commercial logic behind that boredom. So rather than a commodity, housing seems to be, at least on the aesthetical level, a fundamental right, pure infrastructure. And from the perspective of social housing, of an affordable form of living together, that architectural boredom might still offer a viable way to go. Thanks.
I just wonder if you know the book of James C. Scott, Think Like a State? You know, where is, do you know the book Think Like a State from James C. Scott? Where is a little bit this similar thesis where he's showing that, you know, this dichotomy of capitalist and socialist state is a little bit irrelevant when it comes to the to these ideas of maybe managing the society by certain tools, and it's rather the matter of a strong state than a political affiliation. So is that what you were saying about this universality of panel between under different regimes? Is that it? That maybe a little bit similar idea? That it doesn't matter, you know, if it is socialist regime or capitalist regime, that this is not the distinction we should be looking at, but it's rather the power of the state and the tools that are connected to that and how the state is managing the society.
At least I would say that's one part of the whole thing, and this is it would be just the wrong thing to look at it from the perspective of a mere East and West perspective, I think. The question, I think, becomes crucial, or it became crucial, particularly in the former GDR, because the perspective after the end of the GDR, or the perspective of the West onto the housing block of the GDR, the Platte, was something like, we don't like it because it's so monotonous, always the same. The argument was basically based on that striving for difference and things like that. And just by reminding ourselves that that there is a quality within that, also by providing housing on a state level, I think we just need to introduce a little bit more reflective perspective on that, and particularly in the time after the end of the GDR, the Platte underwent enormous. It was bashing a form of living, I would say, which does no good. So I'm not sure if it's that what you meant, but I think, yeah, we should look on different forms of politics that are inscribed into that into these forms of housing, not on a very obvious level, but also on the level how it is produced, how it is distributed, and things like that.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you for your lecture. One question which came to my mind is that apparently in 1960s, on both sides of the curtain, similar things were happening concerning housing production. But my question is, because I know how it worked like in former Czechoslovakia, but I'm not sure about what was happening in Austria at that time. How was prefabrication introduced? Were there some research institutes which were employers trying to make out how to do prefabrication, how to economize housing constructions?
I mean, that's what
was it slow? Was the process slow? Or you were speaking about Vienna mainly, but was it? I think it's the matter of investment, you know, because investment in housing in Czechoslovakia, because it was a central planned economy, was from the state. It was a state. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But what was it like in Austria? Was Vienna different? Or,
yeah, yeah? Vienna was different. That's the point, and that's what I basically also mentioned in the right at the beginning, that this is the story of Vienna or the history of Vienna, and the countryside offers a totally different perspective, I would say. I mean, there were some housing programs also in other cities, but first of all, it concentrates on urban housing in Austria, and Vienna is usually the only city that, in that form, in that also in that scale, went into prefabrication. So it was not an idea to urbanize the countryside, for example, which was rather featuring and promoting single-family homes at that time. Also, particularly by the ERP, the Marshall Plan actually had homes exhibited, like in Linz, for example, showing the ideal home, promoting it that way. But I would really suggest that housing in Vienna took a very different direction than in the rest of Austria already in the 1920s. And kind of, and that it, I think what is really also important is to consider housing as this, what I tried to show, as this sort of a compensation strategy in order to boost the local economy without the investments that the western regions of Austria underwent. But on single family homes, I think we have Michi as an. As a researcher who worked on that topic for quite some time.
So how was prefabrication introduced? Were there some experimental housing?
Little experimentation, little of that. I mean, it's basically.
Or did you buy the technology? I don't know, from the Soviets. Yeah,
was it's buying France technology.
Made a little research during my scholarship in Vienna, and I found out that it was there was a private company, a big company funded or created by the city, and they have 51% of the company, and the rest was this Kami company. So they buy the technology. Yeah, so, and it was also owned partially by this French company. So this was the tool how to introduce this housing.
You're speaking of the of the case of Vienna.
Yeah.
So it's three.
So it was the city who was.
It was
who organized the construction.
It's basically a company, a private company that held, I think, 20%. Then it was Camus as a huge company from France, and the majority was held by the. Municipality of Vienna. Mm-hmm. So
it was this 51%. Yeah, and it's a really interesting situation, because this Camus system was really similar to this G system of Czechoslovakia, really large used in Czechoslovakia, but the production of Czechoslovakia wasn't able to cover this need of the Soviet Union. So they choose this French company to fabricate it or produce the factories for panels in Soviet Union. Mm-hmm. And but the technology was quite similar, and in Czechoslovakia was also really large experimental research already also before the Second World War. So the theoretical and the technological background was really large here and strong, but not the the possibility of production. So it was really it's nice to see that it wasn't black and white this West and East politics concerning housings, that it was connected somehow. You know, that this big French company. Built millions of flats in Soviet Union, or it was organized by this.
Yes. Sorry. No, but this
I'm not sure if I understand you.
Because we are recording the whole stuff, so it would be better.
Right. My question is quite simple. I'll just make a quick observation, and I'll basically say like this. My opinion on the matter, on the whole thing that's happened with the pre-built elements and everything that's been borrowed in Vienna, and the differences that you're saying that are completely different from what's in the countryside, like say Innsbruck or say wherever you go towards other areas, I think it's pure and simply economical what happened, because it was the war. It was the war effort afterwards to rebuild things, and it came up as something really quick to do, where it ignored a lot of urbanistic rules that still exist. While other countries that kept those rules, such as Great Britain, such as Spain, when they have those rules such as like you do not build higher than the like the cathedrals in town, and you are not allowed to build over three stories and such things. I imagine, I'm just asking you here if your opinion is rather the reason Vienna adopted the pre-built method is just so it could do fast buildings to accommodate the people that existed, and it rather did it to spare money without actually looking at what was old. They didn't have to look at the old history and everything. It was just a necessity. That's just my opinion on the matter. Was it a necessity done of economical reasons, excluding political from other communist countries, excluding the whole co-housing idea? Or was it actually something more?
No, I think it's. I mean, what does necessity mean? I mean, there was a need. Let's say there was a request on the market, and that was the driving force at that time when they introduced it. So it was introduced, like panel housing was introduced at a time when actually the scarcity, let's say, the dire needs were already leveled out. So it was just it proved to be some sort of an economically requested product, the housing unit, and that I think was one of the main reasons why to go and continue housing production. Why to decide for the panel, I think, was a decision of labor costs mainly. I mean, there were also other reasons, like year-round production. You cannot build in winter. You cannot pre-produce. You can. But I think the main driving force was really labor costs at that point, which were low in the post-war period, immediate post-war period, and raised up to a level in the late 50s. It became unaffordable to build that way. And I mean, it actually changed the production of housing, not only into panel systems, because that was abandoned rather quickly, but I mean, nobody ever thought about going back to bricks after that turn. So it was, we remained within in building by concrete, just by build concreting on site.
There is a very much in-depth comparative study between panel housing in Bratislava and in Vienna. But it's by Vera Capella, who's of Czech origin, and they worked for 2 years on technical details, on financial details, and how this really compares, even giving the details of the size of the panels, etc. So if you publish 2009, unfortunately, only in German. But this is very. I thought about bringing it with me, but I forgot, unfortunately. Vera Meyer Capella, yeah. She, in former years, she was Meyer. Yeah.
Yeah, just wanted to add some comment about where else in Austria these systems are implemented, and interestingly, for the, let's say, notion of, you know, ideology or lack of ideology. The biggest Plattenbau or panel construction was surprisingly on first set in Innsbruck, but it was for the Olympic Village or for the Olympic Winter Games. You know, and they just took what they considered to be the most modern, most advanced, which you can build as fast as possible, to be handed over for social housing afterwards. But you could not, of course, the Innsbruck administration and Olympic Committee had been far from being communist or social democratic. And there are interesting also investigations about the GDR development, that they officially took everything from Russia, but unofficially they got sort of hell of support from Scandinavian companies to building up their prefab factories. So it was officially Russian technology, but unofficially Scandinavian technology. But everybody signed a letter, you know, that he would never tell that the Scandinavian engineers had been here.
A last question, which is, was it meant as permanent housing, or was it just for the time being? Because what came to my mind is experimental housing experimental housing constructions in Glasgow at the Red Road district, where there were very, very high tower blocks, experimental prefabricated housing, and nowadays tearing them down, you know, they're doing big explosions in there, basically. But it used to be what architects supposed in here, it was that it wasn't for forever, you know, and nowadays what we are going to see tomorrow is that people are repairing the panel houses and they are cladding them, yeah, thermal insulation, putting on the facades, and they're sort of trying to make them more, maybe nowadays the housing estates are finished, you know. Maybe they were, before they were still incomplete. Yeah, because they were built very hastily, but now you will see that even less now is, the facades are full of colors, which is also wrong. And maybe you will be disappointed tomorrow, because the urban design is fine, it's all right, there's nothing wrong with that. But the way the houses look nowadays, it's a painful issue, yeah. But were they meant, even in Vienna, to be forever?
I don't know any comment on that, basically. I just know a comment on early housing in Red Vienna, that the mayor at that time said that, because kind of speaking about the size of the flats, he was mentioning that they were still far too small for the individuals. So there was this thinking that over time one should come towards the success, kind of bettering one's way. And this was also the way how the panel system was meant when it was introduced in Russia, for example, in the Soviet Union. From the Austrian perspective at the, or the Viennese perspective at the time of the panel housing of the Montagebau, I don't know if they thought about, I mean, actually housing turned out to be quite substantial, so it will last for some time and then you tear it down. I mean, it's just the modern approach would be just to use it, and if it's not usable any longer, tear it down. Yeah, but that was developed during the high time of really in believing in prosperity and growth. So it was, nobody thought about the crisis we are thinking of 2008 and something like that. It was really kind of, that was so much optimism at that time, that coming from Second World War, striving for economic development, for growth, for all that. So I'm not even sure if, yeah, I think it's a very different perspective today.
But don't you think that the general mentality of Austrians with a sort of lack of ambition for mobility transfers all these ideas to some sort of permanent solution, and instead of that in inventing some alternative models which are not so alternative? But I think you can't think mass housing in prefab houses with the allotment gardens which are just, you know, around the corner, or the park system, you know, where you have your extended living room and the conflicts dislocated.
Yeah, I think Austrians can do that. that's the point. But I think it's also a problem that something like this, that the Viennese way of thinking in housing structures, I think, is really a long-term perspective, which is sometimes, I mean, it doesn't allow for the experiment, as you mentioned it, of kind of just trying out something new, because the Viennese perspective on housing is so, it needs to be super solid and last.